genre shift. Hi, I'm William, and I feel like I'm the slowest runner in the relay race that somehow managed to get his hands on the baton, and I need to give it to somebody who can actually do something with it. It's no secret that the fans of video games are very harsh on the video game to film adaptations, and I think the critics are too. They're always noticing something is a little bit off, something weird about the film. Not the changes, not the specific changes that they will call out as a flaw, but they will also just, they seem to notice that there's something inherently wrong with this adaptation. And I began to notice a pattern here where the horror films seem to be more successful than any of the others, or at least the ones that are heavily horror element influenced. When I noticed this pattern, I really wanted to dig into it and figure out what was causing the horror genre to succeed where others were failing. And that's whenever I suddenly realized the video game genre was horror, and the film genre was horror. But whenever I started to try to analyze other video games and what their genres should be in film, I came to my favorite video game, Halo, and I started analyzing it, started trying to figure out what exactly should this be if it's adapted. But I wasn't going at it alone, because Peter Jackson also tried to make a Halo film back in 2007 with Neil Blomkamp. Together they were going to make, you know, the coolest thing you'd ever seen, probably. But in the meantime, they made these short films to show off the tech, the plan that they had, and like how they were going to shoot it, their camera style, and everything like that. And what we saw from that was truly epic, really impressive. They are a really good start for where I could, you know, analyze from there to figure out what Halo is, and then go back into the game and figure out why they felt so right whenever they made those shorts, and why other adaptations of Halo went so wrong. In the end, we saw a bit of a disaster in the Halo TV show. Many people do like it. They're usually not Halo fans. And I think that that's not really up to the changes they made. They made a lot of changes in that TV show. They changed things like the super soldiers have no emotions. They have a computer chip in their brain that inhibits emotions. And this is very against Halo in the novels. They very specifically had the technology and did not put it in the super soldiers. But this kind of change, among many, has very much annoyed and upset the Halo fan base, because it was better before it was changed. Whenever other films, like The Lord of the Rings, have felt great whenever they change things, cutting people entirely, like Tom Bombadil, the wild early caveman style people who lived in the forest that were between Gondor and Rohan, just north of the mountain range of Gondor. And these changes, among many others, are actually solid changes, good for the film. And it's not that there's a difference between good changes and bad changes, that the change itself can have any empirical value. What I've figured out, I think I've figured it out, is that the changes, it's all of them together. It's the guidance of the changes. It is shifting the genres of these works of fiction from one to another. You end up with, you know, The Lord of the Rings is great. It maintains its genre. The horror films are great. They maintain their genre. But the Halo films that came out, the short films that Peter Jackson made, who's really good at adaptations, he maintained the genre. They were a war film. And it really does boil down, I believe, to the shift in genre for your fiction. If you make an adaptation, it needs to maintain the genre of the original adaptation, even if you change things. If you cut Tom Bombadil, it's fine. But if you don't, if you make a major change and you those changes lead to a shift in your genre, then that is where it fails. It's not about bad additions. It's about additions implemented badly. You understand what I mean? So this is an actual empirical, like a litmus test, something you can actually follow if you work in, you know, in film. This is something you can use as a guide. You can think about the rewrites you're doing and what genre it's shifting and creeping your fiction into. Halo should be a war film, and I'm gonna explain exactly why in a moment, because I think it really does need to be analyzed to tell you how to do it if you don't already know. Because I bet the people who made the Halo films, you know, for Halo Evolutions and the TV show that came out recently, I bet they watched every cinematic of the cutscenes. You know, all of the, you know, video games have gameplay elements, and then the gameplay comes to an end, and it basically shows you a short film, like a like an episode of the story, and then there's more gameplay, and then there's another continuation of the story. I bet a lot of the times, whenever these adaptations are made, a lot of people are studying those animations. They may even play the game a little bit, but they're studying those animations, those cinematics, to build the cinematic version of the same, you know, story. And in the end, it's the cinematics are not the same genre as the gameplay. And that's the problem. I'm going to get into exactly how to analyze it by using Halo as an example. So now we get to our example, Halo. What is Halo? So you get into the gameplay and you're playing it all the way through. You immediately come up against enemies, aliens on a spaceship. So right off the bat, you know, you're getting this idea that maybe this is some kind of like Star Wars thing, you know? Maybe it's a space opera, maybe it's some action film where we're gonna have lots of combat going on and the hero is gonna be this epic hero all the time, you know what I mean? Some like, you know, maybe the Mandalorian. And that's fine. That's a good first impression of the ballpark of where you're going. But we need to go in deeper. The first thing you find out after that is you get allies. There are Marines everywhere. You're on your own ally ship. Every Marine is looking up to you, literally, because you're so tall, looking up to you as a super soldier. You know, this guy, you know, that guy right there. Super soldier, major armor, energy shields protecting him, like all sorts of stuff. This super, like walking living tank practically. And the Marines are all super impressed with you. You're a superhero, maybe. Maybe that's what's going on here. The way they're acting to you is, once again, pointing it out to you. This is an action film. You're a superhero. This is what's going to happen next, right? This is what the genre should be in this film. But no, refrain. Start thinking a little clearer, a little bit closer, looking to what's happening. The gameplay is not telling you that you are this unstoppable juggernaut. Sure, you're effective, but you start losing Marines. They start dying. The enemies are killing them while you're learning how to play the game and kill the enemies, the aliens. The enemies are throwing grenades that are sticking to Marines' bodies, literally. And they try to get away. They jump out of the way and dodge. And then they explode in a giant blue plasma burst. This is not action. This is not an action film. You just watched a soldier on a battlefield get blown up by a grenade. And the gameplay, because of the way it's designed, especially in the later Halo games, whenever they start adding these elements to the HUD, like I said, your heads-up display, what's on the screen that tells you what the game is doing, they've got text on the screen that tells you the name of the Marines. It'll list out every single Marine that's nearby you, and it'll tell you how much health they have. These gameplay elements are no accident. And they're not just like something there to make it easier to know how like fast you're going to lose your forces so that you yourself are more disadvantaged. That's not what it is. The cinematic communication there is to make you care about these Marines. You don't just, you know, get concerned for them because they are Marines in a game. No, they're just an NPC. There's no player playing them. They're just computer code, right? So you inherently know this and you just start going on this epic adventure until you see one of them die and you see their health appear at the bottom, you know, their names appear, you see their health appear on the screen. All this stuff tells you you're responsible for keeping these Marines alive. You are not just here to kill the enemy. You're responsible for keeping these men and women in uniform from dying. It's really interesting. It's something that film doesn't do that. Film can't do that. Film can't make you feel responsible for the characters in the film's survival. Video games can. But what was the cinematic genre that we learned here? Sure, that's a mechanic between the characters we learned, but what's the cinematic genre element? What is this contributing to? Because remember, the cinematics in the video game are like 5 minutes long, and the gameplay for the mission that's right before it is 45 minutes long. The cinematic is worth like twice as much time, so it's really worth like 10 minutes because so much happens in it. It's a lot more compact and to the point. But the gameplay is still worth like 3 or 4 times that in how it communicates genre. And so you need to boil that down. And so what was this? What was it that we learned from these Marines and their health points and all this stuff that we've gotten just right out of the... This is the third thing we've noticed about this game, is these Marines are on the battlefield and you're responsible for keeping them alive. What is it we learned? It's a war film. Immediately we get this idea that these people are in... They're in deep shit. They are in the trenches. It's just the trenches are a spaceship. And they're dealing with this enemy alien force that are actively trying to kill them. It is not an action film, and it's not what, you know, the TV show for, you know, Halo even communicated. The TV show for Halo has a few scenes that feel very war film, but they ultimately went with a very action and almost political drama of, you know, story. It's a very action thriller drama is what the cinematic genre that they landed on. But that's not what Halo is. You keep on looking and you'll keep on finding it. Every step of the way, the Halo series is a war film, because that is what Halo is at its core. And that's why everything else that has been made about it has sort of been kind of floundering. The books get it right. The books narratively pull off what Halo is. But speaking of the books, we need to really bring it back in. We need to talk about the narrative, genre that is, you know, in your adaptation. Let's step back for a second from Halo and talk about genre itself, because it's my opinion that the genres of, you know, various fiction, various mediums, is a lot like dimensions. Novels have one genre. It is a literary genre. It's like a one-dimensional story. And then you've got, above that, you have the music and comic books. Comic books bring in an image, and this kind of imagery can create a second version of genre. And then musical genre also adds a second one. You've got your written lyrics that create a story similar to what you'd have in a novel, but then you also have the layer of music and the rhythm and all of those things. This creates a totally different double-layered genre. Now, we don't really think this way with, you know, comic books are so close to novels. We usually think of it as just the one genre, and we just have different genres, like superhero genres. There aren't a lot of superhero novels, but there are superhero genre comic books everywhere. That's because that genre is very difficult to accomplish in novels, but because you have the visual to go along with it, you can make more action. You can make it feel like there's more action with this visual language that sort of tells you what's happening. And this genre can now exist where it couldn't exist as easily in novels. And it's usually very, very limited in the novel forms. And then then music, we also don't think of them as novel, as literary, you know, novel-like genres, but in reality, we are actually accomplishing. We're making love songs just like there's romance novels. We're making all sorts of things that are just very similar. It's just that we are calling it a single new genre instead of thinking of it as the musical genre separate from the, you know, literary genre. But I really do think that we need to evolve our thinking on genre in general, because literary genre exists in both of these. I think that there's a cinematic genre, and I think there's a musical genre, and I think there is a literary genre. I think that comic books are actually hitting that space where it's got a bit of cinematic genre and a little bit of literary genre, but true, you know, like films, like cinema, have the cinematic genre, it has the musical genre, and it has the literary genre. I just named it. What video games have is an additional genre beyond these. And this is where it gets, like, dicey. Very difficult to really track what's going on. It's got its cinematic genre, it's got its narrative genre, and it's got its musical genre. But the video game industry has an additional one where you can actually directly interact with it. So if you think about it, it's sort of like dimensions. You've got one, two, three dimensions, and time isn't exactly a dimension. It's space-time. It's part of all of the other three dimensions, just like gameplay interacts with all three of these things. You see what I mean? So it really does boil down very similarly to physics and the way that the universe is built. So what you need to do to adapt a video game down, to boil it down back into, you know, a cinematic-only experience, stripping away the gameplay element and the interactability of the video game, is you need to boil that experience, the gameplay itself, boiled down into a cinematic genre, a narrative genre, a musical genre. But the cinematic genre needs to suddenly take in, sort of like absorb, what is going on during the interactive part and turn it into cinematic. And I do not mean that you should necessarily go in and put in the HUD, the, you know, heads up display, the elements on the screen show your health, and the motion tracker that tells you where the enemies are. I am not saying that you should do that. I'm not saying to literally turn it into the cinematic, you know, aspect of your film. I am saying that you need to figure out what is at essence in that, because different games, the way they play are a, you know, it's a set gameplay to accomplish certain emotions in the player, certain, you know, thoughts in general. There are games that will be a first person shooter that should be adapted into an action film purely, that should be a, you know, a superhero movie maybe. And there are others like Halo that should not, that do not belong to that genre. It's not an action film. And that's a thing that really you need to figure out how to do, is play the game and analyze what the game's gameplay is trying to accomplish. And then I'll let you look to the ones that are successful. Mario movie just came out and was wildly successful. The old one was not, with, you know, the live action one was terrible. But, you know, and The Last of Us was great too. So, like, if you want to go on after this, after I've explained what went wrong with Halo and sort of see what went right with these other ones using the same techniques I'm about to explain, then I think that you'll be able to learn from this and actually be able to implement it in ways that I could never even dream of. I am not someone who could make a film. I could probably write something that could be turned into a film, but I would need help. I would be part of a writing team. But I think I've just figured out what the flaw is. I figured out the problem, and now we need someone to come in and create the solutions. You see what I mean? If you're trying to adapt a video game down to a film, you have to remember to maintain that narrative genre as well. Because, see, the thing about it is that the Halo video games actually fall into the narrative genre of a planetary romance. But you wouldn't think that by watching the TV show. Planetary romance is one where your planet itself that you're on is like a character. And then they kind of tried to go into the novels about what was happening in the novels for the story, but they shifted that genre whenever they brought it up. And then on top of that, they didn't even get Marty O'Donnell to do the music or emulate it. But Microsoft was in a legal battle with Marty O'Donnell at the time over them not paying him all of his royalties. And I think he won that one, if I'm not mistaken. But the point is that I don't know for sure, but I think what they were doing was they're trying to distance themselves from using his music. So then they had little excerpts of it, but like they failed on reducing the video games into cinematic. They failed on the literary genre and they failed on the music genre. And so the show felt completely wrong. Everything about it failed. And now I talked about the very beginning. I mentioned that it's not about the individual things you change, right? The things that you change individually, like Lord of the Rings, to cutting out, you know, Tom Bombadil, shifting the elves from being this jovial, dancing, singing, like civilization. That's very different from the very stern, you know, very well-performed elves that are in Peter Jackson's version. But that change worked because it was still within genre. It maintained the same direction of the genre. But now, but in the Halo TV show, okay, they have all these changes they made. And individually, they, at their root, core, sound like they would work. You have a young woman whose father is an insurrectionist. That means he's against the military that the main character, the Spartans, are part of. And this war is the outer colonies farthest from the human civilization are sort of being made to be like farmers that are just bringing back food to the way overpopulated planets in the middle. And they can't do it at a very high price because they have to feed a lot of people. And this creates a, you know, bit of a war here, civilizational, like almost a civil war. And they call them the insurrections. The people who are fighting to try and separate themselves from this organization. That's great. Have one of them. They almost never touch on that in the video games. It's only in the books. It's like it sort of shapes why the Spartans, the super soldiers, were made in the first place. Before the aliens came in, they started making these guys. And the reason was because they had to outdo these outer civilizations and subdue them. And then the aliens attacked whenever these guys were 15 years old. So having one character they introduced was this daughter of a insurrectionist sort of warlord. And she would have been a great addition. Her actor was great. The writing about her, like the story of her character, was really interesting. her personality and how she behaved, though, was a action film. She did not behave like it was a war film. Her parents, her father dies, her entire like town is destroyed, and she's rescued by the super soldiers, and for some reason she's still angry at their organization and is not angry at the aliens that had attacked and destroyed it. She doesn't say, wow, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. I don't like you guys, but I still think you're better than the alternative, and we need to sort of work together. She doesn't start to do warfare film mentality. She doesn't, like, pretend to ally with them and then run away and go AWOL or anything like that. No realistic human reaction. It's action film reaction. It's superhero reaction. They tried to make her like a lesser superhero in the same superhero film that was about these Spartans. And that is the flaw. And the problem was that they shifted the genre. They lost the soul. They lost everything around these characters. And the changes they made, the addition of these characters, was wrong. They could have added them. But the addition of the character was off. There was the war film is going this way, and that character's written like an action hero. And then this other one's written like an action hero. And then this change to how the Spartans are, where they don't feel emotion. Then they remove the inhibitor chip, and now they can feel emotion. And then they're starting to become rebellious too. And it doesn't feel like a war film. The way they're accomplishing it is like a political drama at that point. So now they're veering into political drama. And then this character kind of goes into political drama, but it's mostly action film. It's all over the place, but it's never in the direction of a war film, except for some battle sequences. Like the very first introduction of that character, who is an insurrectionist's daughter, is her civilization getting attacked by these aliens and what happens. And it's epic, but it's also real. They've got characters being hit by plasma bolts, which are so hot, they're plasma, they're not just fire, they're beyond they're beyond gas into the field of plasma. And when they hit your leg explodes with energy. You pop like a balloon. It's realistic and it's gritty, more gritty than the games, but it really does, by being gritty, starts to accomplish this idea, this war film aesthetic. And then they continue on into the story, and it starts immediately veering into superhero film, and then it goes into political drama, and then in the end, we end up at a completely different thing. And then there's a scene in the middle on episode 5 that's this big battle, and it feels so right. It brings it back in. It's a war film again. There are soldiers that are dying and trying and struggling, and you can see the struggle in their eyes, and you can see what they're doing. And it's framed a little bit around the battle with more of this action hero-y kind of nonsense. And then it gets into the war. Because Master Chief, these characters, they are not superheroes. They are not action heroes. They are the cavalry. They are the cavalry in a war film. We're not talking about an action film. And that's the problem. All of Halo the game is always you rolling up, rescuing a group of Marines that are in a down dropship that had crashed, you know, and you're rescuing them from this. You're rescuing them from another, this or that or the other thing, or you're finding the super weapon key. It's one thing after another. You are the cavalry coming in and saving the day. And the books knew it too. I've got the books back there. The books knew it too. In the second book, which is a retelling of the first game, the first book was a prequel. In that one, they add things to the story. William C. Dietz was a fantastic writer because he added to the story but still maintained its war film vibe, because he was ex-military, but also he went in and added new characters and things like that that maintained this. There was a character who did what Master Chief, the main character, was trying to do in the games, but he did it before Master Chief, and he fails, and Master Chief finds his dead body so mangled that this parasitic super nasty creature in the universe, I don't want to spoil anything if they finally get the TV show back on track, but he fought so hard and so long and held out for so far into this place that he was trying to get the super weapon key that I've been talking about, that he dies there and Master Chief finds his corpse. It's so mangled they didn't even touch it. They didn't even try to turn his body into a weapon. It was too damaged. He takes its dog, that Marine's dog tags. He gives him a moment of silence. He contemplates what this ODST is, Special Forces, not the Super Soldiers, just Special Forces, Marine, basically. What he had to go through to get here, what he witnessed, what horrors he went through right before his death, and then he moves on and he takes the dog tags with him. And this is a scene from a war film. It is not an action film, but unfortunately it's too late. I made this film or this video. I wanted to make this video 2 years ago because Halo TV show is not out yet. And then I wanted to make this one last year because the first season had come out and it was a train wreck. And I wanted the second season to be able to right the ship. And they've already wrapped filming and they're already in the editing phase and it's like about to come out. It may even be out by the time I finish editing this video. It's too late. If they didn't figure it out on their own, that they've shifted the genre and that's the problem with their adaptation, then it's too late. Everyone else can learn from it and can adapt from it. And this lesson is from, it's trial and error. It's all of these adaptations that have tried and failed and then others that have succeeded. And we can now look back at the pattern. We can figure it out. If it's horror, it shifts to horror and it works. If it's war film and it shifts to action, it doesn't work. It's a bad thing. Whenever these additions to the story are written in a direction that shifts the genre of the story. Changes are good. Changes are good. But the reason I have Game of Thrones up here, next to Lord of the Rings, is because I was planning on talking about it too. And how in the later parts of Game of Thrones, in the beginning, they kept the genre. It's a political drama. That's what it is. It's not a high fantasy. The original books, they hit these high fantasy elements. It is a fantasy, but it's not high fantasy. There's magic, there's dragons, you know, there's prophecies. But those are all elements of the political system that is going on in this story. The politics are stronger than the fantasy. You do not have a character pull a sword from a stone and become king because the politics are more powerful than the magic sword. You don't have Aragorn, you know, who inherits the sword of his ancestors and becomes king. And then, you know, from then on, he is this great king who marries an elf. You have the politics determine who is king. The small folk can determine who's king. The real, the meat of the political genre is what is this cinema, this literary genre here. And whenever they turned it into film, they did a great job with every season because they were adapting it almost directly from the novels. They took out a bit of the fantasy elements and boiled it down to even more about the politics. And you know what? That was a good sense. You know, they honed it down. They really did refine it into more political drama. And then at the very end, when the Night King showed up and all that stuff, they did not keep it political. Once they stopped following the novels, when they got beyond what George R. R. Martin had written, their genre began to shift almost immediately. The suspension of disbelief is tied to the genre, and you lose us when you shift genres without us knowing and without you hanging a lantern on it. If they had characters behaving like, man, the world is like magic is back in the world, like the novels are implying, with the glass candle that lights on fire when the dragons are first born in the novels, but they don't go into it in the show. You don't have a single character saying, this is everything is really weird lately. Why is everything happening right now? No one is questioning it. It just shifts and it's wrong and it makes everything feel wrong. And that's the problem. When you make those kinds of decisions in writing, you have to hang a lantern on it. But they didn't. And they shifted their genre, and it went bad. Here's another example right here. The Witcher TV show that started off as like an adventure high fantasy, where the main character is a Witcher. He's a high fantasy exterminator who takes out these big beasties. And the big beasties are so strong that one of them entering a kingdom can derail all of their politics, cause the royal family to like fall into, they could be wiped out or fall into, you know, some kind of corruption or just in general, just terrible behavior. a whole bunch of stuff can happen. Everything can hit the fan when just one of these monsters gets into one of these cities. So politics is weaker than the high fantasy, right? In The Witcher? And then, in the newer seasons, in season two, about halfway through it, right? There's some point, maybe a third of the way in, there was a point where I felt it. The genre shifted. It was a political drama. They were trying to make Game of Thrones. They shifted it to where the politics were more important. The spellcaster's magic, oh, that's cool, but it's not as important as the political thing that they're doing. Even in the Wizard's Tower, where, you know, where all these people are doing their things, their magic isn't the important thing here. It's what they're saying to one another with their politics. Interpersonal character development is important, but it doesn't, that political leaning into a political genre, it feels off the rails, everything feels wrong, and of course, that's why Cavill walked away. It didn't feel right. His character doesn't even matter anymore. Why would his character be there? The genre was a sort of sword and sorcery adventure fantasy, where he's trying to take down these monsters because so that humans who are lesser can squabble their petty politics. He wants humans to be able to live their lives as they want to live their lives, so he is eradicating the monsters that would kill them and upend everything humans want to do. That's a completely different genre than the humans' politics are defining what's gonna happen in the realm now. Ciri is a magical entity. She is like a monster, but she's a good monster. She's going in the good direction because she has the powers of a monster with magic, but she can go in with prophecy and she can go in the direction that will help humanity in the future to live the lives they want to do. This is the story of The Witcher, but the genre shifted. Cavill walked, and now who knows what's going to happen in the next season. But season three wasn't any good. It was pretty terrible. The fans are like, what's going on here? This doesn't feel right. I want to point this out. That's why I have The Hobbit up here, the novel. The Hobbit is not a high fantasy. It's an adventure fantasy. It is about the adventure they're going on. The magic and everything like that is boiled down to almost silly things. Like, even Gandalf's magic is like comedic or cartoonish by comparison to what happens in The Lord of the Rings, because this is a high fantasy and The Hobbit is an adventure fantasy. And it's almost like fairy tale. And whenever, you know, Peter Jackson, the genius who does adaptation, said, I can't make this. And he wanted to produce it and let Del Toro make this film. And Del Toro is really good at adventure fantasy and the weird, the unusual, the very Feywild sort of esque, like strange weirdness of like Pan's Labyrinth kind of thing, right? So Peter Jackson, who knew better, he knew he would shift the genre, said, I'm not making that. Someone else needs to make that. I choose Del Toro. And then it went south. And politically, outside of the events of the movie itself and its production, the production went south. Del Toro, there were problems where I think they removed Del Toro. I don't remember the details of this one. But it ended up, because he was in contract to make it, Peter Jackson had to step in and direct them himself. And he genre shifted it. He turned it high fantasy. He added characters that shouldn't have been there. He made characters behave in ways they shouldn't behave. He knew what would happen. He told them what would happen, and it happened. Because his specialty is not that genre. And he knew he wasn't good at it. These are the failures that you can look at. You can look at these failures, and you can say, that's the problem. That's the pattern. They have shifted the genre. Their additions to the story were done carelessly. It's not about bad additions. It's about additions implemented badly. You understand what I mean? You know, Quan Ha, the insurrectionist from Halo I talked about, that was added to the show, at her core, she's a good idea. In her implementation, she is a failure. And I haven't even started to talk about the human that is in the alien faction, the aliens who hate humanity because their religion tells them to. Also, political drama, because it's in the politics of the Covenant. When the Covenant's politics come into play in a Halo story, it is how they affect the battlefield. They are the supreme dictator in a World War II film. They are giving a speech as a war film propaganda, you know, style of story element. And that's Halo. But they didn't do that, and that's the problem. And you can learn from this. You can learn from all of this. You can learn from the successes. You can learn from the predicted failures by the guy who succeeded and then made the failure. You can look at what succeeded for so long as they maintained their genre and then suddenly shifted at the end and fell flat on their face at the finish line in the ninth inning. You can look at what took so what succeeds every time because it's an easy shift. It's an easy transition. It's horror genre in the video games. The video game is designed to portray everything about the horror genre in the same way as the horror films. It adapts easily. You can look at what failed. You can even look at what's adapted from other fiction or from other things. The superhero genre started to succeed when they started looking at the comic books as a storyboard. The most successful, best Spider-Man film is Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, in my opinion. It's just phenomenal. And the way they play with frame rate. Anyway, the point is, this isn't about that. We got what you need to do if you're making a film is focus on the genre. Figure out your narrative genre of your video game, not just the gameplay genre. Figure out the cinematic genre of the gameplay and figure out the narrative genre of its story writing. Don't drop your music genre. Hire Marty O'Donnell, Microsoft. Like, what the fuck are you doing? He's now retired, though. So he's done. He's finally finished and retired. So you lost your chance. Every opportunity. And stick to your guns. Stick to your genre. Don't lose it halfway or near the end. Halfway or near the end. You gotta stick with it. You gotta find the right genre. Stick with it. And if you do want to shift it, for whatever reason, hang your lantern on it. Let the characters notice that something about the world has changed. How events are occurring has changed. Write in a Mandela effect, where it feels like the world was different before. And now it's this, and we don't understand why, but we have to keep moving forward. Do something like that if you want to shift your genre near the end or halfway through. Do your magic. Come on, Witcher writers. Write in that the magic has changed. Fate is different. Make it not just something that I could imagine might be the case. Hang your lantern on it and make it so that Ciri has shifted the world and Witchers are still important for when a monster shows up, but they're not the end-all be-all, since that's what you're freaking going with anyway. Hang your lantern on it. Let the Witcher notice this change, for example. If you're gonna do it, I don't advise you do it at all. I think you should shift back to, you know, adventure fantasy, but you've already done it. You're already in, you know, in the water. Keep going, keep pushing, get to the other side of that river. Figure out how to do it right. But, you know, anyway. This is something I've been thinking about for a long time. And I know I have a lot of energy in this. And I hope you enjoyed the video. And if you did, like and subscribe. I want to make stuff like this in the future, but mostly I'm going to talk about video games, probably. But I will touch on this and adjacent subjects as well. I'm very small on YouTube, and I would like to grow. So if you like and subscribe, I will appreciate it. Comment. One Piece just came out. Live action One Piece. I'm not even a One Piece fan, but I watched the first season and loved it, but I hated the art style, so I couldn't finish the series. I hated it. I'm sorry. The art style bugged me. But the One Piece TV show is great. It captured the genre. It did a good job. It's